Welcome to this video. And in this video, we will be looking at the pole placement design technique as a state variable method of design for controllers. The pole placement design. Now, the pole placement design enables us to design a controller such that the closed-loop poles of the system will be located at the desired locations. In other words, we have in mind where we would want to place the poles of the closed-loop system, and we make use of the pole placement design technique to design a controller such that at the end of the day, the closed-loop poles of our system will be located at the exact location where we desire them to be. Now, the pole placement design technique also helps us to include the initial conditions of the system if necessary. So we can make use of the initial conditions of the system and incorporate them in the design of our controller. The assumption under the pole placement design technique is that all the state variables are available for measurement and feedback in the given system. Therefore, the assumption that we make under the pole placement design technique is that all the state variables are available for measurement and feedback. That means we can be able to measure all the state variables of the system and feed them back into our given system as a feedback control system. We make use of the state model equations that our system is defined by x of t derivative is equals to a x of t plus b u of t, and our y of t is defined by c x of t. From the state equation, we can represent the system in block diagram as follows. So we have our input passed through B, this is our U of T. Then we have a summing point where we sum after feedback. Having passed through a matrix A, our X of T, and therefore this is an integrator. Since this is our X of T derivative, we integrate that to get our X of T. And this is our X of T. So we make use of the state equation, which can be modeled in block diagram as shown. We introduce a controller, and the control law is defined by U of T is defined by negative K X of T, where K is a feedback gain matrix. So we measure the states, we feed them back through a feedback gain matrix K as a negative feedback system. And through this, then we can be able to modify the system such that the location of the poles or the closed loop poles of the system will be at the desired location. If we modify the system, then our system will look as follows. From our system, we are introducing a feedback system at this point, then feeding back through a gain matrix K and the system will look like this. This is our x derivative of t through an integrator to get our x of t, which you are feeding back through a matrix A. Sorry. We ought to have a summing point at this point. We have a summing point. This is our matrix A. And then our input is no longer an external input, but is an input as a feedback. We tap back, we measure our state variables, we pass them through a feedback gain matrix K as our input to the system, and this becomes our controller by pole placement design technique. Now, the design of the controller will involve the following. One, we need the specifications. We need the specifications of the desired closed loop poles. We need a specification that states where exactly the closed loop poles of the resulting system should be. And from there, we determine our feedback gain matrix K. The necessary and sufficient condition for any given system to be designed under the pole placement design is that the system must be completely controllable. And therefore, before we carry out the pole placement design, we must check that the system is completely controllable. The controllability matrix M is defined by M is equals to B A B A squared B all the way up to A N minus 1 B, depending on the order of the system. If the determinant of the matrix M is not equal to 0, that means the matrix M is non-singular, then the system is controllable. So we first evaluate the controllability matrix M obtained by the expression M is B, A, B, A squared B, all the way up to A, N minus 1, B. We evaluate its determinant, and if its determinant is than 0, then the system is completely controllable, and therefore a controller can be designed for it using the pole placement design technique. For us to determine the gain matrix K, we can use three methods as follows. The first method is what we call the direct substitution method. So the assumption is that first we test for controllability, we test for M, and we confirm that M determinant is not equal to 0. And once we have confirmed that the system is completely controllable, we can proceed to determine the feedback gain matrix K as follows. Now, if the locations of the poles or the poles of the system are given as mu1, mu2, mu3, all the way to mu n. If the desired locations of the poles are defined as mu1, mu2, mu3, all the way to mu n, then we can obtain the desired characteristic equation, We can obtain the desired characteristic equation as follows. So we'll have S minus mu 1 into S minus mu 2 into S minus mu 3 all the way into S minus mu n is equals to 0. That would be the desired characteristic equation based on the specifications of the location of the poles for that given system. Now, from the block diagram representation of the controller, we can notice then that when we introduce our feedback gain matrix K, then we can write our x of t derivative to be equal to A x of t minus K x of t multiplied by B. This will be the new state equation based on the feedback gain matrix K being introduced into our given system. From this, we notice then we can obtain the characteristic equation of the matrix A as, or the characteristic equation of the system will be Si minus A plus Bk determinant. So from the controller or from the system, the new system, the characteristic equation of the system will be Si minus A plus Bk is equals to 0. And therefore, we know then that from the system, the characteristic equation can be written as Si minus A plus Bk determinant is equals to 0. If we have these two characteristic equations as equation 1 and equation 2, one based on the location of the poles and one based on the introduction of the feedback gain matrix K, then if we equate the two, we can solve for K. And therefore, our determination of K will be obtained by equating equation 1 to be equal to equation 2, from which we can obtain the value of K. Depending on the order of the system, our K will be defined as K1, K2, all the way to Kn. Our K will be defined by K1, K2, all the way to Kn. And through this, then, we can solve for the value of K by comparing the two equations, equations 1 and 2, which are the characteristic equation of the system based on the location of the poles and based on the designed controller. Method number 2 is called the Ackermann's formula. By Ackermann's formula, then the feedback gain matrix K is defined by a matrix whose values or contents or all the elements are zero, apart from the last term as 0, 0, 0, but the last term is 1, multiplied by the inverse of the matrix M, and then multiplied by phi of A. By Ackermann's formula, K is defined by the matrix 0, 0, 0, 1, M inverse multiplied by phi of A, where M is the controllability matrix defined by B, A, B, A squared B, all the way up to A power N minus 1 B. The phi of A, this is phi of A, is obtained as follows. We first determine the desired characteristic equation based on the location of the poles. And following the example or the first method, where we had the location of the poles as mu 1, mu 2, all the way to mu n, That means the desired characteristic equation of the system will be S minus mu 1 into S minus mu 2 all the way into S minus mu n. Upon expansion, this one will give us a polynomial in S as S power n plus alpha 1 S power n minus 2 minus 1 plus alpha 2 S power n minus 2 plus all the way up to alpha n minus 1 S plus alpha n is equals to 0. To get our phi of A into the characteristic equation, we replace S with A as follows. Phi of A becomes A power n plus alpha 1 A power n minus 1 plus alpha 2 A power n minus 2 plus all the way up to alpha n minus 1 A plus alpha n I is equals to 0. Our phi of A will be obtained by substituting for S is equals to A into the desired characteristic equation of the system. And this will give us our phi of A. And through that, we can obtain our feedback gain matrix A from the Ackermann's formula. Lastly, number three is the determination of the feedback gain matrix K by what we call by use of the transformation matrix T. Transformation matrix T. By use of the transformation matrix T. Now, given the system defined by x derivative of t is equals to ax of t plus bu of t, then the use of the transformation matrix T method goes as follows. Number one, we check for controllability. We first check for controllability as usual. So we determine M given by the matrix B, AB all the way to A power N minus 1 B, and we make sure that M determinant is not equal to 0. Number two, we determine the characteristic equation of the matrix A. We determine the characteristic equation of matrix A as follows. So Si minus A determinant is equals to 0. This will be a polynomial in S of order n as S power n plus A1 S power n minus 1 plus A2 S power n minus 2 plus all the way up to an minus 1 S plus an is equals to 0. So we determine the characteristic equation of the matrix A and we obtain a polynomial in S with the coefficients ai all the way from a1 to an. You can call this equation 1. Number 3, we determine a transformation matrix T. We determine a transformation matrix T that is able to transform the system into controllable canonical form. T is a matrix that is able to transform the system into controllable canonical form. If the system is already written in controllable canonical form, then T is an identity matrix I of the same order as the matrix A. If the system is already in controllable canonical form, then T will be an identity matrix of the same order as the order of the system. Otherwise, the matrix T is obtained as follows. T is given by MW where M is the controllability matrix and W is a matrix obtained from the coefficients of the characteristic equation of the matrix A. Take you back. From the characteristic equation of the matrix A, we can obtain W as follows. So we are saying that the characteristic equation is Sn plus A1 Sn minus 1 plus A2 Sn minus 2 plus all the way up to An minus 1 S plus An is equals to 0. The matrix W is defined as follows. Sorry, this is W, matrix W, from the coefficients of the characteristic equation of the matrix A is defined as W is, so the first term is An minus 1, An minus 2, all the way up to A1, 1. Then we have An minus 2, An minus 3, all the way up to 1, 0. If you follow the same procedure, you notice that we are taking the coefficients and shifting them one position. That means we'll have A1, 1, and all the other terms will be 0. And the last term will be 1, 0, with all the other terms being 0. And this is our matrix W. For example, if you have a second order system, the matrix, the characteristic equation of the matrix A will be S power 2 S squared plus A1 S plus A2 is equals to 0. That means then our W will be equal to N is 2, so An minus 1 will be A1, so A1, and then the last term is 1, and then the last row will be a row of 1, 0, and that is our matrix W. If it's a third order system, third order, for example, then the characteristic equation will be S cubed plus A1S squared plus A2S plus A3 is equals to 0. That means our W will be the matrix A2, A1, 1, and then A1, 1, 0, and then 1, 0, 0. So that is how we obtain our matrix W from the coefficients of the characteristic equation of the matrix A, from which we can obtain our transformation matrix T by T is equals to MW. Next, number four, we obtain the desired characteristic equation of the system. Desired characteristic equation. The desired characteristic equation is obtained from the poles of the given system. If the poles are specified as mu1, mu2, all the way to mu n, as previously discussed, then the characteristic equation of the desired system will be S minus mu1 into S minus mu2 into S minus mu n is equals to 0. This will be another polynomial in S as follows: S power n plus alpha 1 S power n minus 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha 2 S power n minus 2 plus all the way up to alpha n minus 1 S plus alpha n is equals to 0. You can call this equation 2. So notice the desired characteristic equation is a polynomial in S with the coefficients alpha I. Lastly, the transformation matrix, that is the feedback gain matrix K, can be obtained as K is equals to, so we take alpha n minus a n, alpha n minus 1 minus a n minus 1, all the way up to alpha 1 minus a 1, and then we multiply this by t inverse. And this becomes the characteristic equation or the feedback gain matrix K obtained by using the transformation matrix T that transforms the system into controllable canonical form. In my next video, I'll be taking an example of a controller design in pole placement and solving for K using the three methods. Otherwise, thank you so much for watching the video.